Hello and welcome to Controllers Tech. This is the second video in the ADC series of the STM32. In the previous video we saw how to configure the ADC peripheral, and how to read the ADC data in the blocking mode. Today we will cover the interrupt mode, and the DMA mode to read the data continuously in the background, basically without affecting the other tasks performed by the CPU. We will continue the project where we left in the previous tutorial. Let's open the CubeMX to modify the project. Go to the ADC1, NVIC tab, and enable the interrupt for the ADC. Note that the continuous conversion mode is still disabled. We will first see how the ADC behaves with this being disabled, and then we will enable it later in the code itself. That is all I am changing, the rest of the configuration is same as the previous video. Alright, now inside the main function, start the ADC in the interrupt mode. Once the ADC finishes the conversion, an interrupt will trigger, and the conversion complete callback will be called. Inside this callback we will process our result. Here we will again read the ADC value, and store it in our variable. Then call the MAR function to amp this value in the range of 0 to 100. Let's change this minimum value to 1700, as this is what we got in the actual result. Let's build and debug this project. Keep in mind that the continuous conversion mode is still disabled right now. We will first see how the ADC behaves with it being disabled. I am setting one breakpoint inside this callback function. Alright, we have hit the breakpoint. This means the ADC has finished the conversion, and that is why the callback is called. We will read the value and map it in our specified range. Now resume the debugger. We do not hit the breakpoint again. This means that the ADC is not converting the results anymore. You can see the count value is increasing, so the while loop is working normally as it should. This is happening because we have not enabled the continuous conversion mode. We can still make it work by calling the ADC start function again inside the interrupt callback. Let's test this part. Alright, we keep hitting the breakpoint. This means that the conversion is happening continuously. Let's test the output with the slider. The count variable is incrementing every 500 milliseconds, so the while loop is working normally. Let's move the slider now. You can see the value variable is more responsible now. The value is increasing as we are moving the slider towards the other end. The interrupt is working fine, but this is not the way to do it. We do not need to start the ADC each time the callback is called. Instead, we can just enable the continuous conversion mode. Let's browse down to the ADC initialization code, and here change it to enable. Now the continuous conversion is enabled, so the ADC will automatically start the next conversion as soon as the first one is finished. Since we are using only one channel, the same channel will keep converting continuously. I have disabled this function here, so let's test the project again. The breakpoint is hitting again, that means the interrupt is triggering continuously. Let's remove the breakpoint and run the debugger again. We will now test it with the slider. You can see the value variable is changing as per the slider's movement. So the ADC is working fine in the interrupt mode also. The conversion is taking place in the background, and the while loop works as usual. Now keep in mind that if the ADC clock is very high, the interrupt will trigger at a higher rate, and this might make the while loop unusable. To prevent this, make sure that the ADC clock is at a reasonable frequency. Now we will see the use of DMA. Using DMA for a single channel is useless, as the conversion complete interrupt will trigger at the same rate as in the interrupt mode. So basically we do not have any advantage. I will demonstrate how to use it anyway. We need to enable the DMA, so open the CubeMX again. Now go to the DMA settings, and add the DMA. We want to enable the DMA for ADC1, the direction is from peripheral to memory, and the DMA priority is low. Select the DMA mode to circular, and make sure the data width is half word if you have selected the resolution higher than 8 bits. The circular mode allows the DMA to continuously request the data, whereas in the normal mode, the DMA will request the data only once and we need to start the DMA again for another request. We also need to change the data management mode also. Here we have the option for one-shot DMA mode, which is used when we want to receive the data using DMA only once. Whereas in the circular mode the DMA will continuously request the data from the ADC. The circular mode is used along with the DMA circular mode. We have another option available in the F446RE for the same. Here you can see the image showing the configuration for the F446. We have the option for continuous DMA request. So if you want to enable continuous data reception, this must be enabled. We do not have any option in the F103C8, so we will only enable the circular mode, and the data reception should be continuous automatically. Let's enable this continuous conversion mode, as it is needed for continuous data reception. That is all we need to configure, click Save to generate the project. In the main function, instead of the interrupt mode, let's start the ADC in the DMA mode. In the DMA mode, we need to provide the array where the converted channel data will be stored. Let's define a 16-bit array of 10 elements, which is basically 20 bytes in size. Since we are using a single channel, we will request the data for one element. Once the data is transferred by the DMA, it will trigger the conversion complete interrupt, just like the interrupt mode did. We can also request the data for all the 10 elements. In case of a single channel, the DMA will receive the data for 10 elements from the same channel, and it will then trigger a single interrupt for all 10 elements. We don't need the getValue function, as the converted data is already stored in the array. The received data is stored in the 0th element of the array, so we will use it to map the value within our specified range. We have got a warning here, and that is because the array is defined as 16 bits, while the function expects a 32-bit variable. Let's typecast it to the 32-bit pointer. Alright, let's debug this project. You can see the 0th element of the ADC value is varying, as the DMA is continuously updating the data in it. The count variable is incrementing every 500 milliseconds, so the while loop is working fine as well. Now we will move the slider. The value variable is updating as expected. The slider is on the extreme right, and the value is 100. Now the slider is on the extreme left, and the value is 0. So the DMA reception is working fine also. Let me quickly show what happens when we receive the data for all the 10 elements. We can take the average of all the 10 elements and then feed the result to the map function. But I will leave it as it is. You can see all the elements of the array vary in the similar manner. The DMA mode is more useful while converting multiple channels, and we will see it in the future videos. The rest of this video is exclusive to the Cortex-M7 based MCUs. While using the Cortex-M7 based MCU, we must enable the instruction and data cache. It is recommended by the street, as using these cache improves the system performance overall. The cache configuration is available in the Cortex-M7 section. Now we know that when it comes to cache, the DMA does not operate as usual. We will first see what issues there will be, and then how to solve them using different methods available. So I have only enabled the cache, the rest of the code is still unchanged. Let's build and debug the project now. You can see that the ADC value array is not updating at all. The count variable is incrementing as usual, so the while loop is working fine. The breakpoint inside the callback function is continuously getting the hit, that means the interrupt is triggering at the usual rate. It's just that the data is not being updated, and this is called the cache coherency. It will always happen whenever you try to use the DMA with cache enabled. I have already discussed it in my MPU-related videos, which you can find in the Cortex-M7 playlist. These videos discuss the issues, and how to resolve them. You must check out these videos if you are using, or planning on using a Cortex-M7 based MCU. Anyway, I will summarize the solution here quickly. We need to invalidate the cache in the region where the ADC value array is located. To do so, we will first relocate this array to some other memory location. This can be done by using the section attribute. We need to define this ADC array section inside the flash script. Here I am relocating it to the address 30 million hex. It is basically at the start of RAM D2. Alright, let's build the project once. There seems to be some error in the relocation. Actually, there should have been spaces here. Alright, everything seems fine now. Once you click on the main file, you can see the RAM D2 is now occupied with 20 bytes. If you check the memory detail, you can see that the array has been relocated to the RAM D2. Now the first method to deal with this issue is that we invalidate the cache each time before the DMA transfers the data. We don't have an issue of data loss in case of the ADC, so I will just invalidate the cache here. Call the function invalidate data cache by address, and pass the address of the ADC value array, and the size of the array in bytes. Note that the cache must be invalidated before the DMA transfer starts, but since data loss is not an issue in ADC, we can afford losing the first data value. You can see the ADC value array is now updating as it should. If we move the slider, the value variable is also changing according to the slider's movement. So the DMA is now able to transfer the data, while the cache is still enabled. There is another method to deal with the cache, where we can use the MPU to set the memory region non-cacheable. Let's open the CubeMX, and open the Cortex-M7 section again. Enable the MPU with privileged access only. Enable the MPU region, and set the base region address same as where we located the ADC value array. The ADC array is 20 bytes in size, but here we have a minimum size available as 32 bytes. So let's set 32 bytes. Set the access to all access permitted. Disable the instruction access, enable the shareability permission, disable the cacheability permission, and disable the bufferability permission. That is all for the MPU. Click Save to generate the project. I have commented out the invalidate cache command, so now we are completely relying on the MPU configuration. Here you can see the MPU-related code has been generated at the end of the main file. Alright, let's build and debug the project now. You can see the ADC value array is updating as usual. So the DMA is working fine again, with the cache being enabled. This is it for the video. I hope you understood how to use the interrupt and DMA to read a single channel of the ADC. We will continue the series in the next video, where we will start reading the multiple channels of the same ADC. That is it for today. You can download the project from the link in the description. Leave comments in case of any doubt. Keep watching and have a nice day ahead.